Good morning, Wisconsin. Morning, world. It's a new day. Thanks for kicking it off with us right here at WFHR. We hope you're having a great Thursday out there. Happy Friday Eve. Got your host, James J. behind the mic. I am joined by... Don't tell me. Don't tell me. I know who this is. It's been a couple of days. It's been a while. Seth. Seth is with us.
Good morning, everyone.
Head of production, our co-host, Seth Halfhacker.
Everything moves so fast in this business, I tell you.
The best listeners in radio. We appreciate you being here, Skylar. Seth, darn it. I'll get it.
You'll get it.
I never forget her name. Our good friend, Brittany Merlot, joining us right now. Good morning, Britt. How are you?
Good morning. I am fantastic. I just love the frost on everything. It just shows that the colder season's around the corner.
I'm with you up until I have to scrape my car.
Yep.
Is there anything worse than scraping your car early in cold weather?
In the morning, cold weather might be dark out. Yes. Yeah.
It's got to be one of the first top things. But it's the way it goes. It's the course of things. And as you say, it is getting colder out there. We're definitely setting into colder temperature season.
Yes, we are. And you know what? I have a response to, is there anything worse? I think for females, sitting on black leather seats and shorts is worse than scraping frost off your car. Just saying.
Survey says, yep, Brittany's right. Brittany was right. Yes, that is worse. Yes, definitely.
Oh, goodness. I just, wanted to close out the warm season in a good way. So we're going to say goodbye to that, sit in some seasonal high temperatures here for the rest of the week and even into the weekend. I mean, we're still going to get shoved decently warm today. I mean, we should be in those low to mid-50s. We're going to reach the low 60s. A nice sunshine to start, but more and more clouds increasing throughout this afternoon, and the wind's starting to get feisty, too. But they'll be out of the south, gusting up to 20 miles per hour, and that's why we're getting so warm today. So enjoy it while it's here, because by tonight, we are looking at rain rolling in, which is good. We don't want this high fire danger anymore. We want to have some fall bonfires safely. So this rain is good stuff. Looks like it's going to hit our area sometime after 9, and then kind of roll through about midnight. Probably expect about a quarter inch of widespread rain, although some places, if we get underneath a storm, we could see about a half an inch to maybe an inch of rainfall. Kind of depends, and it's going to be scattered throughout the state, but there is a possibility of some decent rain. So, fingers crossed for that, because I'm tired of the drought, I'm tired of the high fire danger.
Agreed. Yeah, here's hoping. We'll be on the lookout for it, and we'll be better prepared for it, thanks to you, Brittany. We appreciate you so much. We'll get people ready for the weekend tomorrow.
Sounds good. Can't wait. Have a good day.
You too. Have the best day. And the best in the business right there. Brittany Merlot joins us every morning right in this time slot. Seth and I got fun stuff on the way. We got the El Cafe Birthday and Anniversary Club. We'll also get into garbage bags. Have we been doing it wrong?
What? I've been doing it wrong this whole time? Oh, man.
My dad is going to be so mad at me. What are you talking about? Halloween PSA. Candy wrappers are not flushable. Goldfish crackers are rebranding.
That's interesting. That's really fascinating.
We'll get into all of that. And, of course, we are on a Thursday here, so we'll kick off the 9 o'clock hour with our good friends at the Southwood County Humane Society.
Yeah.
And our pet of the week. We're able to do that thanks to our friend Luann Goetz. I want to say a big thank you to her for that. A shout out to her. We appreciate her sponsoring the segment.
Yeah.
All of that coming up for you. We'll get into some entertainment news. We'll talk about some great stuff going on in the locally as well, theater-wise. And in the 9 o'clock hour, 13 things everyone experiences when they become an adult, but no one talks about. I have not pre-read that.
Ooh, that'll be fun.
We'll see what that one is.
Yeah.
But I wanted to start here a little bit going across the pond with you, Seth.
Okay.
Britain's Home Office issued an official passport for the fictional character Paddington Bear after a request from the makers of the upcoming film Paddington in Peru. Rob Silva, co-producer of the film, said he and his team contacted the Home Office asking for a replica passport to use in the movie.
Okay.
The document bears Paddington's photo, as well as his June 25th birthday and his birth location in Peru. Paddington's from Peru?
I didn't know.
What? When did that happen? happen.
Oh my God. I haven't gotten into the Paddington Bear universe. Yeah, I guess I don't know his backstory.
I don't know the origins. I gotta look into that.
Man.
Paddington in Peru, the third film in the franchise, is scheduled to be released January 17th, 2025. These movies have done really well.
They have.
They've
amazingly
been very
successful.
Yep. And I don't know. I've heard that a part of it is the animation. Part mm-hmm. of that, they've kind of stuck with that with the Paddington character. Mm-hmm. And that kind of helps. But it's just a universally liked character.
Right.
Everybody loves Paddington. I like that bear.
Man, it's one of those things that of all the, it's part of that group of children's books that, like, for whatever reason, transcends generations. It's been going on for like 50 years now that passes it down to the next generation.
I can't think of many things creatively that must feel better than something like that.
Oh man.
You know, you're especially a children's story. It's mm-hmm. one thing for an adult story or a teen story or something to have longevity, but for mm-hmm. a child story to be able to. That's pretty impressive. I as a side note, I do have to ask, and please 715-424-2600 if you know the answer to this. Why do bear characters never have pants? Never. You never see a bear character with pants.
That's very, very. I'm trying to think of.
Yogi's got pants and not a shirt. Is it
No. He just has like a bow collar.
He just has a bow tie.
He's got a collar and a tie.
He doesn't have shirt or pants. He's completely buckwheat. He's really living his best life. Paddington got a jacket, so it's a little bit better.
Right. Fozzie only has that little ascot thing that he's got. Yeah. That's a great question.
Which a Fozzie Bear and Tony Curtis, only people that can pearl off an ascot, I think. I think they're the only ones that can. I'm just curious. I'm not at all judging. All
no, right? no,
Live
not
your
at
best
all.
Best lives, bears. I'm not at all going to tell you where to do what to do.
Is it a coincidence that the word bear and the word bear
uh-huh.
are homonyms in the English language? They're spelled differently.
Something there.
But they're the same word. Maybe that's what it is.
There's something there.
Did we solve something here today, James?
Yes, we just solved something.
See, I knew that vacation would pay off.
Yes,
I knew it would.
Yes, those scepters are ready to go. This is a fun story. That's a fun story.
That's not
right
bad.
There.
No. But Peru again, really? Wow. Okay.
Yeah, Peru. Interesting. I just assumed he was
a Peruvian bear. Yeah.
Yeah. But that is an interesting one. And should be fun. What are the things that they're able to do with that character? Because it is in an English setting mm-hmm. and stuff. Usually, at least.
Yep.
Is be able to reach out more to other, Spanish or European cities or countries or anything like that, and really expand that mm-hmm. universe, if you will.
The Paddington verse.
Yes, the Paddington verse. Wait until they get this, all the multiple timelines.
No.
I want the multiple timelines of the Paddington universe now. Back past Paddington.
Oh, my gosh,
I wanted to touch on this, and we will again before the end of the show, because it's important. The Domestic Violence Awareness Month vigil that is happening tonight from 6 to 7 o'clock over at the Wisconsin Rapids Community Theater at 223rd Avenue South. We encourage you to join us for this. This is a community event. This is a event for us to all come together to heal, to hold, and to center. Mm-hmm. That is the theme for this year's vigil. Mm-hmm. The vigil, of course, is celebrated every month, every October, as October is Domestic Violence Awareness Month.
Right.
Now, we do a morning show, and if you guys notice, if you've been listening for quite a while, I try my darndest to wrap up every single segment we do with a joke or some positivity.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Sometimes it ain't funny. Sometimes I fail horribly, but I'm going to try, because that's the essence of our show. That is what Carl and I wanted this mm-hmm. show to be, and that's what it'll always be as long as I'm in this chair.
Right.
Once in a while, I've got to touch on something that there is no me wrapping up on a funny note. Not mm-hmm. with this topic. Yeah. And we also would try very hard to give you a very easy ease into your day, a positive start to your day. Well, this is not one of those topics. This is a black and white topic. You are either on the right side of history or not when it comes to this.
Right.
There may be no topic that I am more serious about or more direct about because of the importance of it.
Mm-hmm.
Domestic violence literally affects every aspect of our lives. Domestic violence, I don't care if you are living in a shack on the outskirts of town and you don't even talk to people, all you do is pay taxes, guess what? This affects you too.
Mm-hmm.
It literally affects everybody, and it affects generations. Mm-hmm. It affects not just families, like the people being in the abusive situation, what have you, but the children in that situation that didn't ask to be in that situation.
No.
It affects every aspect of our society, every aspect of our community. When a vigil like this is taking place, it's not only great to go to have some camaraderie, mm-hmm. to have those organic conversations that you might not have otherwise.
Right.
Maybe see some people you haven't seen in a little while, but to show where you stand on this subject, to show where you stand with people who have been affected by this, to make sure they know you are not alone. Mm-hmm. So, and to the abusers out there, to the cowards, and you know how I only use that word when I feel it is apt. It is apt. When these cowards that hide in the shadows, they are unable to hide if we shed some light.
Mm-hmm.
And if more and more people are doing this, and more people are comfortable talking about this, the less they have. They thrive in this stuff. They are a fungus. They thrive in the dark. They thrive when people are afraid to talk about things. We are not afraid. We will not be afraid anymore. Going forward, this is the way we talk about this. There is no putting the genie back in the bottle. We're only going forward with this subject.
Mm-hmm.
I encourage you to be on the right side of history, and I certainly encourage you to help the Family Center any chance you get, Hannah Center any chance you get, some of these great organizations we have in our area. And if you can be a part of the vigil today, we'd love to have you. It is going to be a good community moment, I believe.
Exactly.
The vigil, again, will be tonight at the Wisconsin Rapids Community Church, 6 to 7, right over there at 223rd Avenue South. Now, when you get there, I have a cot that I have set up because that's my second home.
Right.
Just try to avoid that. I've got a couple of little Simpsons things set up and everything.
Just ignore him.
Don't even bother me. Don't even mind me. You can find out more at familyctr.org, familyctr.org, and encourage you to follow them on social media as well, everybody.
Yes.
We'll come back, do some celebrating with the El Cafe Birthday and Anniversary Club. It's coming up on the morning show at WFHR. You heard the boys. It's time for the El Cafe Birthday and Anniversary Club. One of our favorite parts of the day, we get to celebrate you and our great friends over at El Cafe. Encourage you to treat yourself. Get on over to El Cafe, 221 Market Avenue in beautiful Port Edwards. Wish them a great day from all of us here at WFHR.
Yep.
Got some great things going on over there at El Cafe, and they got their haunted house coming up over there.
They have a haunted house?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
They've got that going on over
there. Trick-or-treating there, yeah.
This Sunday, trunk-or-treat. It's going to be a lot of fun. Be sure to check that out, everybody. El Cafe wants to invite you to their first annual haunted house at El Cafe. That's going to be a lot of fun. That's going to be a lot of fun. And of course, get us your birthdays and anniversaries so we can celebrate with you. Info at WFHR.com, james.mailoff at civicmedia.us. You can, of course, direct message us on our Facebook pages, whether it's WFHR or WIRI. It's all right, either one.
Yep.
And of course, call up
424-2600. Now the phones are alive and working.
Yes, thank God. Yes.
Shout had a little out. Problem earlier this week. A
couple of quick shout-outs to our engineering team, to Solaris, getting right on that and getting those things working real quick for us. We really appreciate that.
Yes, the lines are open.
And as long as I'm throwing shout-outs, a real quick shout-out to our own Melissa Kay. We had a bit of a curveball over the last 24 hours.
Yeah.
And you might have noticed that our news is a little bit longer now.
Mm-hmm.
That could take a little more... another minute of news could be a lot more work.
It is. It is, absolutely. And the sad note, the sad thing is that we have to hear Melissa 1 minute longer. She's getting mad with power, I think, is what's happening here. I'm going to talk about that tomorrow.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. She'll be with us on the morning show tomorrow. And just shout out, Mel.
Yes.
Nice work.
Good job.
Like, and, we appreciate you getting us those birthdays and anniversaries, everybody. Seth, I need a 1 through 3.
Let's do 2 in the middle.
All right. Gives us that qualifier. We can get right into the celebrating. And first up, we want to wish a...
Uh-oh.
Sorry, I just saw a text from Melissa.
Did she respond to my comment?
She did, yes. We want to wish a very happy birthday to Natiana Huckabody.
Happy birthday.
Threw me off.
Sorry.
Natiana, now she doesn't, I don't believe, I'm not sure actually if she works there anymore. I don't think she does. I met Natiana working at Stoiber Healthcare.
Oh, okay.
She's a masseuse over there.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, I worked with her in a couple of plays over at Wisconsin Rapids Community Theater. Theater.
Yeah.
A fantastic actor. Cool. What an actor. Great performer. Wonderful team player. And an incredible masseuse.
Yes.
Maybe the best I've ever had. I am not comfortable letting people touch me. And I did not know her that well.
Right.
She couldn't have made me feel more comfortable. Nice. Or more loose. And I think that's a great credit to
it's
a human
being.
The
best masseuses are like that. Yeah.
Incredible wife. Incredible mom. Natiana's awesome.
Cool.
Enjoy your day, Nat. Enjoy your day. We wish happy birthday to Sarah Williams.
Happy birthday, Sarah.
Enjoy your day, Sarah. Hope it's a great one for you. And we wish a happy anniversary to our qualifiers. Happy 65th.
Whoa.
65.
Whoa.
To Tom and Joan Oligny.
Oh, Tom and Joan, congratulations. 65 years. That is remarkable. That is amazing. That I'm sorry, it threw me for a loop. I interrupted James and everything.
So, wow. That's a great one. That's 65. That's impressive. I don't know if we've had one that high this month.
No.
That might be the
it's been a while since we've had in the 60s. Yeah.
Would be the leader in the clubhouse.
Yes.
Tom and Joan, enjoy your 65th. And thank you, everybody, for getting us these birthdays and anniversaries. Appreciate y'all.
Keep them coming.
We take a look at our celebrity list right now. Drake's 38. Ouch.
We'll just mention that in passing. Yeah.
I'm just going to keep on moving. B.D. Wong is 64. B.D. Wong.
Wow.
Great character actor.
Love him.
If you've seen, he was in American Horror Story, the TV show Gotham he was really good on. He was fantastic on the TV show Oz. Law & Order SVU had a really nice run on there as well. Usually plays a doctor. Like almost every role
yep.
he plays is a doctor.
And so many. I mean, you just scratch the iceberg. He's been in just a working character actor. He's been in like probably hundreds of projects.
I really enjoy his work.
Yes, he's good.
Very good actor. Very good at transforming to the role.
Mm-hmm.
And if you play a doctor more than four or five times, should you get college credits for playing a doctor? Like if you've been on Grey's Anatomy for like the whole run, should you like get some credits
you'd
for
think
you know,
that you'd have
something?
Learned a lot, right? You know,
I've played either a sheriff or a deputy about five times in my career. I've played an attorney four times.
Right.
I feel like these things, like, I'm not saying I get a badge, but no, I'm joking.
No.
I'm kidding. One of my favorite actors of all time, Kevin Kline, is 77.
Oh, love Kevin Kline. He's semi-retirement, I would say, because he still pops up here and there with projects that he, you know, just surprisingly shows up in. It's great, though. I love it.
Interestingly enough, since his big movie, I would say A Fish Called Wanda,
mm-hmm.
since that movie, he's really been able to kind of pick and choose a lot of his movies.
100%, yeah.
He's not a guy who's ever cared that much about fame and certainly doesn't need money.
Mm-hmm.
So he's been able to kind of like, okay, I want to play the president, so I'm going to do mm-hmm. Dave, and I get to work with Sigourney Weaver.
Yeah. Right.
Movies like that he was really good in.
I can't remember that. Is it DeLovely where he plays Cole Porter?
Yes.
Probably
yes,
one of my DeLovely, favorite yes. performances. Oh, he was excellent in that.
I'm pretty sure that might be his best performance.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That probably non-comedic performance,
yes.
at least.
Yes, very dramatic. Very well done.
I do want to send a shout-out to him, though, too, because the Lorraine Bouchard, the creator of Bob's Burgers and a lot of other great shows, he is a bigger Kevin Kline fan than I am. And he reached out. They told him this would never happen, that it's ridiculous. Why would Kevin Kline do a voice on your cartoon show? he reached out just by chance, and Kevin loved the script, loved the character, loved the idea. It's like, yeah, I'll do it. And like Kevin Kline's been on every season as Mr. Fishorder, the landlord of Bob's Burgers.
Oh my gosh.
And he is one of the wildest, craziest characters. His brother on the show is played by Zach Galifianakis.
Oh my gosh.
Who those two together have some incredible chemistry. And it's really cool. Kline doesn't get paid more than $5 for that role or whatever.
You know, but yeah, the minimum for sure. Yeah.
The minimum for actors
yeah.
and continues to do it. And I really like that kind of thing.
Man.
Great actor.
Is he one of the most versatile?
Yes.
He's like up there with me with Michael Caine, who could do anything. Mm-hmm. I think Kevin Kline is right there with him.
Another legendary actor. F. Murray Abraham is 85 today.
Oh, wow.
He killed Amadeus. Mozart.
Yes, he did.
That is probably what he's most famous for.
Yeah, Salieri, yep. From Amadeus, yep.
But has done plenty of great
roles.
Oh, my
gosh.
Plenty of great roles in his career. And fantastic career.
I loved him in Scarface. I know,
oh my
god, he gets killed in it, but he's really good.
it's one of those performances that stands out. It's one of the, and it's really saying something that when you have that. The Grand Budapest mm-hmm. Hotel is one I wanted to mention.
Yep.
On Mighty Aphrodite. But he was on. I don't know if he's still on there or not. But he was on the TV show Mythic Quest. that is a fantastic show on Apple TV.
Wow.
It stars Rob McHenry from Always Sunny.
Mm.
It's got Danny Putty in it, okay. A couple of other big actors you'd know, and it's all about the video game industry and creating stuff. F. Murray Abraham plays this he was a famous sci-fi author.
Oh.
And he was at the start of the sci-fi movement,
mm-hmm.
and they kind of referenced that in a throwback episode, and it's a beautiful episode. It's one of the better episodes of TV I've ever seen.
Wow.
And it's all about his origin story idea that he's kind of like a joke, and what use is do for you as a writer? And then all of a sudden, these video games start coming out, and they need somebody to tell the stories. So they hire him to tell this, to create these stories for the video games.
Right.
And it's something that actually happened in real life. Not with him, his character isn't real, but they reference Amnoff and all the legendary sci-fi writers.
Oh, right,
and everything.
Right, right. Mm-hmm.
It's a really cool show.
That's neat.
His performance is fantastic in it.
Love him.
We celebrate Santo Farini, 87, of Santo and Johnny.
Oh my gosh, Sleepwalk.
Top
a famous instrument, one of the great instrumental tunes of all time.
Oh, top five for me. Top five instrumentals of all time.
Mm-hmm.
And
organ. Oof.
If you get the chance to hear Richie Valens doing Sleepwalk,
mm-hmm.
or you get hear Jeff Beck doing it, there are some incredible versions. Santo and Johnny's is, of course, the most legendary.
The most legendary number one hit.
And Bill Wyman is 88, former Rolling Stones bassist.
Wow. Been retired for quite a while, too, if I remember. Yeah, he's like, I'm done with this.
Yes. He's like, what are you folks doing? What
basically.
Are you still doing that?
Yeah.
We wish happy birthdays and anniversaries to everybody out there celebrating.
Mm-hmm.
Happy birthday to Natiana and Sarah.
Happy birthday, you too.
And a happy 65th anniversary to our qualifiers, Tom and Joan O'Ligny.
Oh, have a great time, you guys. Enjoy that anniversary.
It's Thursday. Celebrate right into the weekend.
Just do it, man.
Keep going.
You just celebrate every day.
Yeah.
If you ask me, when you're 65,
yeah,
65 anniversary, every day is a celebration.
Put that on a t-shirt, on a bumper sticker. You are right, my man. You are right. That is a line right there. We will come back with some more lines and more fun. We're going to talk garbage bags. Are we doing it wrong?
Seems pretty simple, but you never know.
We're going to figure this out. We come back on The Morning Show. Welcome back, everybody. Morning Show at WFHR, locally grown radio. Seth and James here with you. We'll be talking a little Halloween in a moment.
All right.
Before we get to that, though, TikTok is back with more dubious advice. A woman's video is blowing up after she let people know they've been using garbage bags wrong the whole time.
The whole time.
It says she was years old when she found out that they come inside out. You're supposed to put the bag on the can like a hat, then push the whole thing down inside. It eliminates the need to shake it in the air.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So is it really true? Have we all been doing this our whole lives? Like so many TikTok facts, the answer is no. It's not really true.
No.
But she's also not wrong. It turns out the inside out myth has been around a while. The mm-hmm. The folks at Hefty weighed in on it after a similar video went viral a few years ago.
Oh, I think I remember that now that we're talking about it.
You can do it that way. You can do it that way. Mm-hmm. And yes, it might eliminate the need to shake the bag out. But it's not really how trash bags are designed to be used.
Mm-hmm.
Hefty reported the video and said, there's no wrong way to line a trash bin. I'm kind of showing...
Just use Hefty bags.
Yeah, exactly. That's the one thing they were saying.
Right, right.
Now, what she's doing doesn't seem like insane to me or anything.
No, not
like
at all.
That. That's one way to do it. It just... I'll be honest. I don't mind the shake. I don't mind shaking
it out. There's nothing wrong with that.
It's part of the process to me.
It has I have to say, it has a satisfying sound, actually. That whip you get when you do it, at least to me anyway, I think that's a cool sound. So I think I'm going to keep doing that. You know what the funny thing about that video was? The look on her face. She was so serious. This is like, come on, man. Yeah, this is the way you do it, man.
I'd love to be able to like really... really talk to this person because she seems like this is something like she wants the world to know.
Seriously.
I don't know. It feels like everywhere from, especially growing up, it was always my job to empty the garbage, take the garbage out. And almost anybody I've lived with, that's been my job. And I can't even imagine how many times I have emptied a garbage and done this with a garbage bag.
Yeah.
And I've never once thought about putting the bag in there first.
And then, pushing it down. Yeah. There could be an issue, too, with air getting trapped in there. You know, if it's the seal is like really, you know, tight, then you're pushing it down. You're just pushing air, and I don't think there'd be issues with that way too. I think
so. You shake the bag, you put it in there, and you're wondering, okay, I got this air in there. How do I get this air out or anything? I think a lot of people know this hack, but you when you're putting it around the bin, you just don't put it completely around the bin yet. Push it down, yes. Then you wrap it around.
Get the air out of there,
yes. And then you got no air in there. Or if you have something heavy to throw in there,
that helps too. That'll do it.
Right away. I don't know. Try it. I encourage you. If it saves you a couple seconds or even just gives you something different to do in this mini, you know, this process that is mundane and, you know, we all have to do.
Let's try this. It might be exciting, you know.
It's taking out the garbage.
Yeah. Not much you can do with it.
Yeah. I encourage people to, whenever it comes to anything menial, like a random task that we all have, dusting, or any of these things, make it fun.
Yeah,
make it fun.
Do it different, man.
Don't matter. It's not just dancing that you have to do like nobody's watching. Like, you can live your life that way.
Clean, like nobody's watching.
To a degree. You got neighbors.
You know, I'm going to say, yeah, I mean, if you're into doing the whole nude cleaning thing, you know, you might want to at least close the shades.
Shut the drapes.
You know.
You got neighbors.
Your neighbors don't really need to be involved in that.
Please. Halloween is 1 week away, so here are a couple of reminders. One, you should really try to stay away from the Halloween candy, otherwise you're just going to have to buy more to hand out to trick-or-treaters. Dad. Sorry, that was a little more direct.
That was a little direct.
Just talking straight to my father right there. Two, if you do get into the candy and you're eating it in secret, you cannot flush wrappers down the toilet.
Okay, that's where this came from. I was wondering how we got to that point. Okay, now I understand.
There are enough people, and let's be honest, enough parents. There's some kids thrown in the mix.
Oh, yeah.
But it's mostly adults that are doing this. But in all honesty, it's one of those things that they are actually running into a lot right now this time of year. And this has been going on for the last couple of years of people apparently going into the bathroom to eat candy in secret, and they don't want any evidence. So, you know, genius idea, or oftentimes a child's like approach to, you know, shoving it under the bed so mom and dad can't see it.
100%. Now let's put this in perspective, people. Okay, it's bad enough how much toilet paper that we use in this country that can cause problems to our plumbing system, and that's made to you know, fall apart when it's been in water for long enough. This stuff does not do that. Nothing is going to happen to those wrappers, man.
Yeah.
It's just going to cause a problem for you and everybody else. Don't do it, please.
And I'm sorry to be this guy, and I'm not sorry to be this guy. Those things are not biodegradable 99% of the time.
No, they're not. Not at all.
It's just going to affect our water. You know, we need that. It seems important. You know, if there are so many people that are tired of hearing PFAS and everything. Well, guess what? There's a quick way to get rid of that. Let's clean our water.
Yeah.
Then we're not going to start. We're not going to be talking about it anymore. And don't do stuff like this.
Hey, parents, come on, just be bold. Just come out with it. Said, yeah, I eat your candy. That's right.
You know what? I can't stand anybody who admires or wants to live in a dictatorship. I can't think of many worse. I wouldn't survive 5 seconds in a dictatorship, no matter what. I don't even know if in a fictional one I would. Any of that stuff.
Yeah.
I say all that with one little tiny caveat.
Okay.
The house. Like, you parents, be dictators. There is no democracy here. You are in charge.
Yeah.
It's okay. That is all right.
Eat the candy.
For one, you know, the kids are not going to eat cereal every day for dinner. I mean, that's not healthy. That's not good. You know, it's okay to be a little bit of a dictator in the house. And if you want to eat candy in front of your, look, eat it. You don't have to hide.
Just
you don't have to be secret about it.
You can be fun with it. You know, the what my kids call it, something, the shadow tax or something like that for candy or something like that.
That's good.
That's really good. I love that. That's sure they heard that from school, but it's like, oh, okay. Oh, sure. I will indulge my shadow tax. Here you go. Yeah, I'll take that.
So add candy wrappers to the list of things you shouldn't be flushing.
Everything. Yeah. There's nothing you should be flushing except for toilet paper. That's it.
According to the Plumbers Association and to a couple of others, the three P's, poo, pee, and paper. That's it.
That's it.
The only stuff that goes down there.
I didn't know that was a thing, by the way. That's awesome. I love that.
I like that they jumped in.
Good job,
in.
Plumbers. Very inventive.
And a great catch line. Great catch. The three P's. That's a good one. That's good. That's work. Good work right there by them. Nicely done. And that's an interesting story, too.
That is fascinating. I never even thought about that.
Now, if we had bidets, wouldn't even be an issue.
Oh.
Wouldn't even be a problem. Would not be a problem.
You know, we have our issues that we really hold dear on the morning show here, and we will have any opportunity to bring those up.
Well, die.
Any opportunity to bring those up.
We're going to do it. That hill,
if we talk about toilets, you know what's coming.
Holding up a bidet spigot just... This is me on that hill.
I love the protest. Yeah, bidets. Yeah,
yeah. Pepperidge Farms remembers. Pepperidge Farms wants young adults to know goldfish crackers are something grown-ups eat, too. So here's the latest marketing stunt.
Oh, boy.
They announced they are temporarily rebranding goldfish and changing the name to Chilean sea bass. They posted a jokey ad calling them more sophisticated and sophisticated and, yes, so more adult. Yes, yes. Lord Longbottom likes this. Yes. Don't expect to see the new name in stores, though. They're only doing it on special limited edition bags that you have to be very fancy to have. Yeah,
apparently, are they charging like a whole lot of money for it?
Yes, it's not worth it if it's not expensive.
That's true. That's true.
They're selling a set amount each day for the next week at ChileanSeaBassCrackers.com, ChileanSeaBassCrackers.com. Fun fact, when goldfish crackers debuted in 1962, they were meant for adults, not kids. Mm-hmm. They marketed them as a new type of snack for bartenders to put out.
Totally makes sense. Instead Absolutely. Of just like peanuts and the old bar food, the pretzels and that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
Put out some crackers. That makes sense.
If you're under 50, you might not know, but bars used to have free snacks. Like pretzels and peanuts.
They used to. They don't, you know.
Yeah, they don't do that much anymore, do they? I hadn't thought about that.
It's insane, man. There's a reason they did that. It was all salty stuff, so you would buy more drinks. Yeah, that was a reason they did that.
You give the clientele a little bit of a base, so they can possibly put more in there.
Yeah, but they're all salty snacks. They're peanuts, pretzels, stuff that has a lot of salt, so there's a reason for that. Yeah.
So maybe the reason it didn't work was crackers aren't that salty.
They're not salty enough.
And I would think that Ritz crackers would be perfect for that. They got a little bit more salt than your average cracker, it feels like. I don't know if that's true, but it feels like it to me.
It feels like they do.
And I love Ritz crackers. Yeah. Ritz crackers are awesome. I like goldfish crackers, too. They're really
goldfish good. Goldfish are really good, but how did they land on Chilean bass?
Yeah. Yeah.
Is that really going to... the logo looks cool. You know, James just brought it up here. That's cool, but... Chilean sea bass?
Yeah.
You could have come up with something a little bit better than that, I think.
I like that they put in parentheses, they aren't actually fish. They're just crackers, just FYI.
Which, why? Because goldfish, they don't do that with goldfish. No. They don't actually eat goldfish, you know.
So I think that this is a little tongue-in-cheek with a little
I'm
bit.
I'm sure.
With them all, certainly trying to get more adults to buy them. But definitely, they seem to have always run things tongue-in-cheek.
They have. Yeah, I got to give them a lot of credit. Actually, they've done some pretty good fun stuff. So
I don't know though. I just like goldfish crackers. Well,
come on, every parent, you know, if you get goldfish for your kids, you're eating some.
Oh yeah,
you know you're eating some. So yeah,
there are very few like foods like that.
No, I can't have this. This is for children. No. I cannot eat this.
Dive on in and get some of those. Enjoy. We'll be back with more show coming up. A morning show on WFHR.
When the spooks have a midnight jamboree, they break it up with fiendish glee. Ghosts are bad, but the one that's cursed, that's the headless horseman, he's the worst. When he goes jogging across the land, holding his noggin in his hand, demons take one look and groan and hit the road for parts unknown, because there's no spook like a spook.
I could just let that man sing all day. Let him sing all day.
I love that turn of phrase with his noggin.
Yes.
Holding his noggin, I love it.
Bing Crosby could sing anything and make it sound happy.
He could do the phone book. He could sing the phone book and it'd been great.
I want to hear Bing Crosby doing Desperado. the happiest version of Desperado.
Oh.
His tone is mm-hmm. is proper. His singing, of course, is yep. top notch.
Yep.
But the way he sings, it just almost can't help. It's like an English person giving you bad news in that right. accent. It's like, well, I'm sorry, but you didn't make the cut. It's like, well, it's all right. Yeah, you know, it's just a happier way of getting bad mm-hmm. news or a macabre story. Right. Like he's singing there, but in his voice, it says, "Oh yeah, the headless horseman holding his noggin."
Love it.
Washington College in Maryland is an older university, and we know this because it's complaining about young people.
What?
Washington College recently announced that they are changing their logo, which incorporated George Washington's signature, because kids these days aren't learning cursive, and prospective students couldn't read it. That may be true, but it's worth pointing out a couple of important things. One, they are still teaching cursive in schools.
They are.
You would think an American university would know that.
Yes.
Maybe do some research on that.
Which is why you're here.
Right. The quote-unquote signature in the logo is very stylized, and it's hard to read even if you spent your entire childhood learning cursive.
Yeah.
I'm going to show it to Seth here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's like people's signature. Actually, that's really kind of a neat signature.
It's a very cool looking signature.
I didn't realize George had such creativeness with his signature. That's very
nice.
That's
one of the coolest signatures I've ever seen in my life.
I love the loop on the T at the end. That's really neat. Yeah.
I may steal that. That is a fantastic way to write a T, and that is the best G I've ever seen in cursive. That's impressive. Well done, father of the country.
Yeah, no kidding.
But it also, I wouldn't have known that's George Washington's signature. I don't read that as George Washington. It's all mushed together and everything.
Yeah, you might be able to check together the Washington part, but you wouldn't know it was George Washington.
And two, Washington College dates back to 1782, when kids who would spend all afternoon on penmanship. But the cursive logo is not that old. It only dates back to 2013.
What?
When kids would spend all afternoon on their PlayStation 4.
Seriously? It's only from 2013? Come on now.
So they changed the font to Comic Sans? No. The new logo uses a more traditional college typography and adds in Washington's family crest. School officials say it's great because it can be used at different sizes and still be recognized. So I'm going to show Seth the new logo.
The new logo.
Here. And there it is.
Yeah. Nothing wrong with that. No.
And it makes sense. I know what Washington. I know what
that is.
That's
Washington College on there. Now they tell us where these colleges are, because you know how many Washington colleges there are, or like similar one. Yeah,
it's a great point.
We never know. How are we supposed to fill out our March Madness brackets? We don't know what these schools are. How are we supposed to do that?
Thank you. This is the important stuff. Now we're getting into the heavy stuff. That's the important stuff.
That's right.
I'm on their website, and I'm still not seeing. Oh, it's in Maryland. Yeah,
it is in Maryland.
We did say Maryland. Yeah.
Yeah, you did.
Chester. I wanted to know where specifically.
Oh, gotcha. Okay.
Chestertown. Okay, so that's
right. Yeah, I don't know where that is. Anyway,
the seal will be used mostly for official documents and the English version for more general uses, like on research papers or presentations or sort of things like that. So they're doing all this, and they're complaining about younger people. They're doing it and then complaining that they have to do it because of younger people. Seth, could you remind George Washington University who their clientele is? Who is, you know, their main clientele? You know what young people
young
really
people.
Like when you complain about them and
talk
then
down
ask
to them,
them
right?
Talk
yeah.
down to them and then ask
They'll
them
love
for
that.
Things. Yeah, that's going to go over real well. That's great. Why not just change the logo and not tell, you know,
and not just say, yeah, we needed to update the logo.
Yeah,
it's something new.
It's not even in 2013. It's not even that old.
It is. It's 10 years. It's just 10 years old. Come on now.
I am glad for this story though to see George Washington's signature, because boy,
that's pretty cool.
That is a really cool signature.
I don't think that was a great decision to begin with.
No,
to use his signature as your logo.
No.
I don't think of George Washington. I mean, there's any number of things you could do to remind you of George Washington. Come on.
The idea that this is a necessity that you need to do this because of the reasons behind the deal.
Yeah.
You want to change the logo up, I get that.
Yeah.
But the reasoning behind it doesn't make any darn sense.
No.
A new report found AI is already saving people an average of 1 hour a day at work.
Oh, wow.
It's kind of interesting.
Okay.
So 35,000 workers were polled, and of the people who use AI at work, the average person said it saves them a full 60 minutes.
Okay.
Energy and utilities was the industry where it's saving the most time at 75 minutes a day. Aerospace and defense ranked last, but still average about 52 minutes.
Okay.
The average tech worker said 66 minutes a day, manufacturing 62 minutes, and financial services 57.
Mm-hmm.
27% of people said that it made for a better work-life balance,
okay.
But 23% said that they're still doing the same amount of work. It's just different.
So there was something to keep in mind here, yeah. Too, that, you know, we really have to rein in a lot of the claims that we've been hearing over the last year or so about what AI is, what it's going to do, that kind of thing. These people are saying that for a reason, because they own companies that they want to make money with this AI stuff. So come on, we need to and that's cool. I mean, it's interesting to see which industries is using it the most.
Yes.
And that makes sense because of what, you know, it's all computer-based stuff. It makes sense. You know, it can help with certain, like, menial tasks that you don't have to do anymore. Hey, great. You know, that's really cool. But it's not going to help, you know, a clerk at a gas station. It's not going to help a whole bunch of other people. These pie-in-the-sky ideas, no, it's not going to work for that.
And we, if we are ever going to reach this plateau, we are decades, if not centuries,
oh, God.
Centuries
so far.
Away from the idea of AI taking over
yeah,
that clerk's
general
job.
General AI, yeah.
Like being able to do that clerk's job
nope.
or anything.
Nope.
And keep AI is not self-efficient. They're always going to need a human being to plug it in. They're always going to need somebody to fix the bugs.
Right.
They're always. I mean, they need us, and we need it. It is not that different.
Yeah, right.
We're beginning to lean more and more into AI, and there are plenty of people, like you said, that are out there that are you know, screaming, crying to the heavens that this is the end of humanity and blah blah blah. Stop watching so many movies.
First of all, yes,
it's centuries we're talking. The greatest yes. minds will tell you this,
mm-hmm.
And
the actual science people mind. Yeah,
you don't even need about. It. You don't even need that. You don't need a survey. You don't need a bunch of reports or anything like that. Every one of you with a cell phone, go ahead and pull it up and try to type something to somebody. And see how AI handles when you put a swear word in there or a word it doesn't understand.
Yeah.
AI can't
Or the word it thinks you want, but you don't want.
It can't even figure out texting, man. I'm not worried about it taking over the world. Now, what I am worried about is while people are just because there's a you if I can just piggyback on your point,
sure.
And it's a good point about the companies and their reasoning behind kind of, you know, creating this fear and creating fear in general. It's really a good line for anybody who talks a lot of fear and tries to scare you every time they talk. If that's all they're doing, they've got an ulterior motive.
Mm-hmm.
And it ain't a good one. And it doesn't involve you. It just is about them.
Yep.
99% of the time when people are talking about fearing something, they are trying to get you to not look at them. Hey, pay attention. No, pay no attention to the man behind the curtain. Pay no attention to the man behind the curtain. That is what that is, 101.
Mm-hmm.
That's all that is.
Yep.
And as people try to get you to be afraid of AI, while they're doing that, they're giving AI jobs of actors, of writers, of creatives. That is the world that they are looking to attack the most.
They want to replace people so they don't have to pay them anymore.
And guess what? They could get away with it.
Mm-hmm.
They could pull it off because around the country, we are seeing cuts to funding of arts.
Mm-hmm.
We are seeing more and more of the arts being cut. This state alone in Wisconsin finished dead last in the union in funding arts.
Mm-hmm.
But meanwhile, you've got right here locally, Lincoln High School being nominated, winning a national award for their theater education.
Woo.
We're going to talk more about that tomorrow with Melissa and everything.
All right.
But you've got things like that going
mm-hmm.
on. Imagine your world without Laverne and Shirley. I'm just pulling something out of the sky.
It's random,
that's
right?
Wisconsin-based and
yeah.
Wisconsin-created right. creatively. Do you think that it's pretty cool that you have the Green Bay Packers and not the Acme Packers? That came from creatives.
Mm-hmm.
How about the Brewers logo? Maybe the greatest, if not, no, hands down the greatest logo in baseball, I think.
One of my favorites.
I think. That came from a creative right here in Wisconsin. There is nothing short. You would notice if the world didn't have the creatives that it does.
Oh, absolutely.
We need to fund the arts. And the people that are trying to get you to be afraid of AI don't want you funding the arts. They want to make this easy and paper cutter.
Yep.
And they want to give you the same old movies. Boy meets girl, boy loses girl. There you go. There you get that movie.
As long as it makes some money, they don't care about
every
that.
Every TV show, big guy, little pretty girl. And they, oh, well, look, they fight. Oh,
but they're really in love. Yeah.
That's AI. That's AI. That's corporate stuff that live in bubbles that don't understand the world we live in. And pay attention to that stuff. It's important, I think.
Yeah.
I think.
The bottom line is, let's just take it easy. We're not at the apocalypse here, like James said. We're way away from there. But at the same time, you got to be aware of what it is doing at what is affecting right now.
There are real things to be concerned about it, just not a lot of the things that they are pointing you in the direction of.
Exactly.
We know you're smarter out there than that, so that's why we're talking about this. One of my favorite bands and favorite people is performing tonight for On the Floor.
All right.
6:30 to 8 at the Fine Arts Center and McMillan Library. Local favorites for On the Floor to return. I'm going to play some of the best jazz you're going to hear in the city.
Love it.
And some of the greatest stories you're going to hear as well. I encourage you to check out Floor on the Floor, 6:30 to 8 tonight in the Fine Arts Center at McMillan Library.
Very cool.
It's going to be a good show, too. They have a great time with that one. That is going to be a lot of fun. Encourage you to check that out.
Yep.
Everybody. And I want to remind everyone as well that to kick off the 9 o'clock hour, we'll be joined by our friends from the Southfield County Humane Society with our Pet of the Week.
Very cool.
Encourage you to check more of that with SWCHS.com. We'll be getting into that in the 9 o'clock hour. Also, get some entertainment news. We're talking Dolly Parton, Netflix doing a documentary on a reality show, and The Pretenders show up in our news today.
Nice.
That's interesting.
I like that.
We're going to talk some local theater as well, and we've got some fun stuff there to talk about, especially. But in the 9 o'clock hour, I want audience participation as well. We're going to get into 13 things everyone experiences when they become an adult, but no one talks about.
Yep.
Adulting 101. That's what we're going to get into. So I think that's the fun one.
Oh, when did that become a verb, by the way?
Yeah.
Adulting.
Yeah, I don't know.
Come on, stop it.
Think that one over, everybody. We want your answers in the 9 o'clock hour. You will be quizzed. That is coming up a little bit later. More show coming up with Seth and James right here at...
This is locally grown radio. WFHR 1320 AM. W248 DE Wisconsin Rapids. And always streaming on the Civic Media app.